Today on the Rock Newman Show, a very special conversation with newly appointed Howard University President, Dr. Wayne A.I. Frederick. He is here today to discuss the past, present, and future of this fine institution. That's coming up right now on the Rock Newman Show. Welcome to the Rock Newman Show from the campus of historic Howard University, located right here in the nation's capital. I'm Rock Newman, and it is my desire to inspire you with personal stories of extraordinary achievement. My feelings about Howard University are no secret. I've said before, and I'll say it again, Howard University is simply the greatest institution of higher learning in the history of the world. Today, I'm joined by none other than the newly appointed president of this glorious university, Dr. Wayne A.I. Frederick. He arrived at Howard as a 16-year-old freshman from Trinidad and rose to become head of surgery at Howard University Hospital. In July, he was named the 17th president of Howard University. Thank you so much for joining us, President Frederick.
My pleasure.
Welcome to the Rock Newman Show. Man, we've got 1 hour in order to go over a lifetime here. So let's get started. Let's jump in. We want to know so much about Howard University, past, present, and future. First, we need to get to know about the newly appointed president, Dr. Wayne A.I. Frederick. You hail from Trinidad.
That's right.
So we really get to know you from way back. Tell us about your childhood days in Trinidad. We had Lincoln Phillips on this show, who coached Howard to a national championship. Mm-hmm. And he told us some stories about his days in Trinidad. We'd like to hear about yours.
Sure. My days in Trinidad were absolutely fabulous. We didn't have a lot. I was born to two civil servants. My mom was a nurse, worked for the public health system, and my dad was a police officer. And I was diagnosed with sickle cell anemia at birth, so my parents elected to stay close to the hospital so that I could receive care. And that occurred for the first 6 months of my life. Subsequent to that, we moved into a neighborhood which would be considered a suburb here, middle-class folks. And we just had a really good time, and I say we because I then had two younger brothers. I'm the oldest of three boys, mm-hmm. and my mom always had a dream of having three boys for some reason.
Really?
Absolutely. She wanted three boys. She wanted one to be a pilot. I'm a little apprehensive about heights. She wanted one to become Prime Minister of Trinidad because she was very infatuated, I would say, with our then Prime Minister, Eric Williams,
okay.
who was Prime Minister for some 20 to 25 years and really got us out of colonialization and was a political science professor here at Howard, which yeah. was my first introduction to Howard.
Uh-huh.
And she wanted one to be a physician. So I tried to tick that box for her. But growing up, she really influenced me a lot, and she would take me to some of her visits in the community to administer health. People would come to our house for bandage changes. In the summers, she would bring me surgical caps, those types of things. Lots of books. I was surrounded by books everywhere. We went in our house, and we were encouraged to read a lot and to really participate. I loved sports, but because of my sickle cell, I could not participate as I would have liked. But growing up, you know, we had fun-filled days in that house trying to make the best of the little that we had.
You know, another surgeon who is fairly well known, Dr. Ben Carson, he often talks about the influence of his mom and that he and his brother were knuckleheads and were getting in trouble, and she just absolutely insisted that they read books. Did your mother have sort of that sense of discipline, or was it something that you came more naturally to do that?
Right, you know, she tells a story that she never really had to encourage me to study or to do that. I had a natural inclination towards books, towards reading, towards participating in school. You know, I enjoyed going to school. In the summers when school was out, I was a little bit down because I enjoyed the learning environment and being in it. Having said that, she did instill discipline around more in terms of our behavior, about us being good people, good citizens of our community, and she instilled that in us by example as well as by making sure we conducted ourselves in a certain way. So the way we interacted with our neighbors and with adults who would come to our home, it was understood that we had to demonstrate a certain level of respect and so on. She also introduced us to the church. We were Anglican, Episcopalian, and I was an altar boy, which is something that's now well known for about 7 years from the age.
That's something we have in common. I was an altar boy in the Catholic Church for a while. So, you know what, let me deviate from the script just a moment here, because you talk about your mother's discipline, her influence, and how you guys had, you know, respect, appreciation for education, that sort of thing. Today in the news, probably one of the biggest news here nationally, is what's going on in the National Football League with the Ray Rice issue and with Peterson from Adrian Peterson from Minnesota with the child abuse. As a surgeon, as a father, and I really have deviated from strip, but let's do this. Can you weigh in on spanking versus not?
Right. So I certainly received a few spankings myself. I don't spank my kids, and I won't. I think that we can interact with our kids in a manner in which we, you know, bring a certain amount of discipline. I don't think we should judge how that is done as long as it doesn't cross certain limits. So I want to be clear, I don't think that spanking is wrong. Spanking within limits, spanking that causes injury, is something that we have to beg a question about. And I think we have to ask that question, and this certainly will bring that question back. And as I said, I speak to my kids. My kids are very communicative, and what I have found in terms of how I discipline my children is that that engagement, they tend to thrive with that engagement. They want to be, they want an explanation about how they should be and how they should behave. On the same token, it has to be balanced against how we reward them, how often do we recognize them when they do right things, and how much we give them that encouragement to reinforce the principles of behavior that we want them to follow. And so, you know, it's very difficult not being in somebody's shoes at the time of an incident to recognize all of the different things, as well as the history that may inform how someone behaves. But I think certainly, as a society, we can't support any type of discipline that brings injury to a child, that would take a child to the hospital and those types of things. I think we have to draw a line.
Get a little back a little bit to your childhood. Other than your mother, were there other strong influences, whether or not that was someone there locally or someone in the news or whatever it might have been?
Absolutely. My maternal grandmother was a strong and still is a strong influencer. Every major exam that I've taken, board exams, etc., to this day, every major interview, when I interviewed for president, I talked to my grandmother the night before.
Call grandma.
I've done that from the time I came to school here, and I've continued to do that throughout my life. She has the most soothing perspective at the right time that, you know, sets my mind at ease and really allows me to focus in on what I need to do. Plus, in a lot of ways, she was really the first person who believed in me. At the age of 3, she recalls me making an inquiry about her having a conversation with some friends about my sickle cell. And my inquiry was, what is that? And why are you talking about me in the sense that I might be sick or I may die? And as she has done throughout her life, she was straight with me. She says, you do have a disease that may cut your life short. And that's the reality, but we're going to work with you. And I said to her that day, as she recalls on my tricycle, that I'm going to become a doctor and find a cure. And she said, absolutely.
Now, see, that leads me right into my next question is, you know, from that childhood and those influences that helped you form who and what and how you wanted to be, what was your dream?
My dream was to become a physician and find a cure for sickle cell. I practiced my Nobel Prize speech many times in my mirror. I knew I was going to thank my mom and my grandmom. I knew what I was going to say about them. But so strong was my dream as a child that it wasn't a question of whether I would become a doctor. It was a question of when. And the sooner I did it because of my disease, that was my plan, that I had to hurry up and get it done because this disease that I have may cut my life short, and therefore I needed to pack a lot into a short space of time.
Okay, so as a child, you had that dream. You knew you wanted to be a doctor. In order to become a doctor, you had to go to school, and you chose the Mecca.
That's absolutely.
Howard University, how did that come about? What factored into you choosing Howard as a place to continue your education?
Sure. You know, it wasn't much of a choice. Choice would suggest that you looked at other institutions and Howard was the one. Mm-hmm. Howard was the only destination. My country at that time, Trinidad and Tobago, had many individuals who were in leadership roles throughout many different fields and industries who were Howard trained or Howard educated. Mm-hmm. And that had a big influence. You know, the obstetrician who delivered my brothers was from Trinidad. You would look at my prime minister, Eric Williams. Yeah. He was in the political science department at Howard. And I can go on and on. There were Howard men and women all around me, mm-hmm. as well as when I look at where my contemporaries were going to be educated, Howard was the primary destination mm-hmm. at that time. And so it was natural for me to want to join that legacy and to come to the Mecca. Mm-hmm.
So you obviously excelled through junior high school. You came to Howard University as what has been said is somewhere south of 100 pounds and, and 16 years old.
That's absolutely right. I was a 5'6", 88-pound freshman.
Yeah.
And I know that because I still have my student health center form I filled out on that day, fully clothed with sneakers on. So that 88 pounds is a little fudge as well. But I was a very, very small young man, which is part of sickle cell. The developmental capacity is one that is delayed in terms of what you would expect in adolescence. So I was particularly small when I got here. But I had big dreams, yeah. and I had, what I discovered when I got here was big support from every direction, you know.
You were manager of the soccer team. I think we have a picture of that time in your life when you were manager of the soccer team. Describe undergrad life on the campus of Howard University.
Fantastic. I thought I had landed.
And that was what year? You came in what?
That was in 1988.
88, okay.
August of 1988. And yeah. I thought I had landed in paradise of heaven. everything about this campus, every day I was thankful that I had found my way to this campus. The environment in the classroom was rich. I was meeting people from all over the world. I had professors from all over the world.
Yeah.
The integrity of the academic discourse that was taking place was incredible. Mm-hmm. It was strong and it was excellent in every way, shape, or form. And I could see myself not just getting the technical components towards a degree with every class I was taking, yeah. but I could see myself getting an education in the fullness mm-hmm. of growing into manhood and growing into someone who
well
needed to contribute to the society, well beyond the classroom. The types of activities that were taking place. I'll give you an example. In the spring of 89, there was a sickle cell benefit that was put on by, I believe, WHUR, and it was held in Bird Gymnasium, and because it was sickle cell, you know, I obviously was encouraged to attend. So I went into the stands, and who sang the national anthem? A cappella, Whitney Houston.
Oh, wow.
Long before she sang it in the Super Bowl, I heard her sing it. As she did it.
That's Howard University.
That was Howard University, exactly. Yeah. So when people were raving about her singing it at the Super Bowl, I said, man, they needed to just come to Howard.
I remember way back when.
right.
And so obviously you come through, you know, flying colors undergrad. You have pretty much your choice of where you might be able to continue your education. But you stay at Howard to get your medical degree.
That's absolutely right. Howard had a BSMD program where you do 2 years undergrad. You go to med school. After the second year of med school, you get your BS degree. And then after the fourth year of med school, which would have been your sixth year of matriculation, you get your MD degree. And I was enrolled in that. So I did have choice in terms of I could have gone elsewhere because I had the prerequisites done.
Right.
But it was no doubt in my mind that I wanted to get my MD degree here. I had a choice, which also was another crossroad, as it were. In my freshman year of med school, the government of Trinidad and Tobago offered me a full scholarship to go to a new med school they started in Trinidad. Mm-hmm. And, you know, because of the financial burden that I thought it would bring to my parents, I went to Trinidad and interviewed and was set to go. And my dean at the time, Charles Epps, convinced me. He said, I can't promise you that we will find a way for you to pay for medical school. But what I will promise you is if you stay here, you will do great things.
If you stay at Howard.
If you stay here at Howard, you will do great things. And I called my mom and I said, listen, I think this is the right place. And she agreed.
You know, let me go off script just once again here. That sounds like some quality nurturing. Mm-hmm. And that quality nurturing, in my opinion, is something that helps make historically black colleges invaluable in our society. Some 30 years ago, Tony Brown, the journalist, led a movement to save black colleges. There was the talk about the merging of black colleges and that there really wasn't use for them anymore. We thought it was then, and we think it is now. What say you about the relevance today of black colleges?
I don't think it's an issue of the relevance. I'll be very honest with you. Mm-hmm. I think it's an issue of can we continue our relevant position in a different dynamic and construct that would allow us to thrive. And I think what must underscore every strategy that we do to get there is excellence. Mm-hmm. We have to exemplify excellence in everything we do. We talk about the nurturing, and sometimes people make light of the nurturing because they see it as a support system. They liken it to welfare, for lack of a, you know, I think a better association, and I think it's unfortunate that people do that. The reality is it is support. It is allowing a 5'6", 16-year-old, 88 pounds, to grow into a man, to recognize that you have a responsibility to the society around you, to make a better way for those around you. And that is what our HBCUs gave us then, and that's what it's still giving us now. All of that was wrapped in excellence.
Yeah.
I was trained in an excellent fashion. When I got to MD Anderson, which was my first foray out of Howard University to do my surgical oncology fellowship, I was meeting people from
MD Anderson Hospital.
MD Anderson Hospital. That's where I went to do a surgical oncology fellowship after doing my general surgery training here at Howard. I was in a cohort of people from Duke, Harvard, Stanford, you name it. And nothing that I did made me feel inferior. Yeah. I became the chief administrative fellow in my last year, one of the few minorities to hold that position at that time. And what I saw every day was the excellence that Howard put into me that I could then display to the rest of the world. So it's not just simply a nurturing in terms of, you know, couching and cocooning.
Yeah.
I want to make people absolutely clear what is occurring here. What is occurring here is that blossoming of that flower that then goes on to provide pollen for other flowers. And that is what the HBCUs do, and that is certainly what Howard University has been excellent at and needs to continue in order to thrive.
So your specialty was surgical oncology.
Correct.
There's a proliferation in the black community, black men, prostate cancer, and related maladies.
Yeah.
Talk about that.
You know, health in general, let's talk about health in general as a construct in our community, in the African-American community. It is one of the cornerstones of what will allow us to thrive. We talk about economic empowerment, jobs, faith. We have to have good health in order to get to those other things and to participate in those other things in a rich way. And most of that has to do with prevention. We have to make sure that our community is being screened for these maladies, as well as that we are creating good opportunities in our community where we can participate in preventative health measures that will provide good health. And that includes exercising regularly. It includes seeing your physician early on. It includes what we eat and how we provide what we eat. And I think, again, this is a place where Howard University must lead. We have prostate cancer screening at the hospital on every Wednesday, as an example, to make sure that men are being tested with a digital rectal exam, as well as checking their PSAs, and we encourage men to do that every year after the age of 45, 50. We think it's extremely important. Same thing in our community with respect to hypertension. We expect you to get an annual physical exam where you can be screened for hypertension and diabetes, which are high, again, in our community as well.
In this day of such uber-advanced technology, we continue to see headlines about declining health, greater obesity, and a number of other medical issues which make our quality, which diminish our quality of life. Why is that?
I think it's because we're not presenting the right choices. We are using technology but not leveraging the benefit of it, as opposed to allowing it to give us a sedentary state. So we're sitting in front of large screen televisions, we're sitting in front of our devices, we're doing a lot less to get to where we need to be. I think what we need to do is to leverage how we can use that technology to better inform us of what we do. So on the same token, we also have devices that will check how far we walk and monitor those things. And I think we have to leverage that technology in the right way. Our diabetes treatment center here at the hospital has a wireless system that will record your blood sugar checks and send them back to your physician. So just imagine on a Saturday night, you go to, you know, grandma's birthday party and have a little too much cake. You have a physician who will get that information on your finger stick and be able to call you and say, listen, you need to take 5-10 units more insulin and no more cake today. As opposed to letting that go through the weekend and then showing up in the hospital on Monday because now the blood sugar is out of control. Those are the things where we have to leverage technology in our communities today to try to get a better outcome. It still will never not allow us to get up and walk around and get into rigorous activity. And we have to promote that as well. We have to keep talking about it in our churches and in our schools very early on, so that people will adopt certain types of lifestyles, so they see it. And then our kids have to see us doing it. I play soccer every Monday night in a league, an over 40 league. Nowhere near as fast as when I was 15 or 16. But the fact that my kids see me go and come every day, even if I'm limping when I come back in the house, right, they recognize that I have placed a premium on that. When they see my wife go to the gym every day and come and pick them up in her gym clothes, sweaty, they recognize that that exercise is a part of what they must participate in.
You are not bashful at all about talking about your faith. And you are a surgeon, so you're in the medical profession, and that has to do a lot with science. And so many say that science and faith never really reconcile. Talk to us about that.
It reconciles in my world every day. And the way it reconciles and manifests is in the miracles that I have seen. It is not lost on me that some of the people I have operated on throughout the course of my career are better because of a higher intervention that used me as a tool. Some of the things that I have seen and the hope that people have displayed when they come into my office and the outcome they've had goes beyond just the science of what I do. There's no doubt in my mind. The first person I ever operated on for pancreatic cancer will celebrate his 10th anniversary of being cancer-free on October 5th of this year. That, to me, is a measure of outcome that I cannot just take credit for because I applied a knife and surgical skill to someone. Yeah. I just don't believe that. I believe that there are greater forces around us that define some of those outcomes. Now, how that intersects, not just with science, but beyond that, also speaks to the other things that must occur around that. I have seen patients come to me in very dire circumstances and then turn around and comfort me and comfort their family members when we all are there to support that patient. And we all leave uplifted. The person who is most afflicted and who requires most of the support then turns around and gives so much of life and hope to the rest of the people in the room. That's not because of science.
So let me share something personal. My mother passed in 98. About a month before she passed, she was pronounced to be brain dead, and that she it was a matter of hours before she died. And she hung on for a couple of weeks, and I remember it like it was yesterday. I was there one Saturday morning, and I was just talking to her. And, you know, she had been unresponsive for 2 weeks. And she started to talk. And she started to respond. So I called the doctor. And I told him, so he thought I was delirious. He really thought I had spent so much time there at the hospital that I was suffering from delirium. And he says, you know, I'm rushing right over. Because she had seen a heart doctor. She had seen a brain specialist. She had seen several people. They all had said, the end is so very near. She's in an irreversible coma. She cleared her throat and started talking. You've had those kinds of experiences?
Absolutely. I have taken care of patients that I can tell you what I did technically, but I can't guarantee you that my technical intervention is what may work. I have had patients come in because of traumatic experiences, whether it was gunshot wounds or otherwise, and be basically in a state where their heart is not working, they're not moving, there's no functionality. And we begin working on them, take them to the operating room, do several things, and then 3 days later, that person is sitting up in a chair talking to you. I've had those experiences on many an occasion. I've also operated on people who had such widespread metastases of their cancer that what my intervention would have done in the larger scheme of things would have meant that they would have lived weeks and had them show up in my office 3 years later.
Right.
And those are not things that I can explain simply by science. I think there's an intersection that goes beyond just science.
I said to my brothers and sisters, I said, all of us heathens in here may never have seen the face of God, but we just saw the work of God. How else do you explain that kind of miracle?
Absolutely. Absolutely. And my own health challenges, I see it as well. The lifespan of the average lifespan for people with sickle cell is 42 years. I can talk to you about all the limitations that are put on people with sickle cell. I've even presented a paper about sickle cell patients, which included me. And somebody got up in the audience and said, that particular patient does not exist. And it so happened that patient was me.
Yeah.
And I was speaking about that fact. So in my own circumstance, in terms of the energy levels that I have and my ability to sustain, you know, it certainly goes well beyond just me hydrating myself and being, you know.
I'm not just talking to the president of Howard University. I'm talking to a miracle that sits before me. let me ask, you know, so you go through medical school, you come out, you're doing your thing, you're practicing your specialty, surgical oncology. You become a husband and a father. How did those things impact your outlook on your profession, and how do they impact your overall life?
Yeah, well, they were transformative events. The first of which, obviously, was meeting my wife, and she moved in with me when I was in Houston, working at University of Texas MD Anderson Cancer Center, and that responsibility for two, and for making sure that somebody else was happy was very, very disruptive and transformative at the same time. And I say disruptive in a good way.
Mm-hmm.
Because, you know, coming and going and thinking about yourself every day is one thing.
Right.
When you bring somebody else into your life, it really gives you a different sense of what's important. And the support that she has brought to me has been invaluable.
Mm-hmm.
Most people who meet her know that she's a very quiet woman. She observes a lot, but she is a very, very deep well. And so when she provides feedback and insight, I'm always absolutely amazed. She has a degree in computer science, but she is wise beyond her years.
You know? And I'm beyond happy that you cleaned up that disruptive term.
Absolutely, absolutely. And then my kids, I would say, again, was a very transformative event, and on a very spiritual level. I lost my dad a month before my third birthday, and it was very important. If I could list for you the things that the most important thing that I wanted to do in life, it was to become a father and to have somebody call me dad the way I was not able to call someone dad growing up, but also to develop a relationship with a young man that I could get there. Every time I do these interviews, somebody comes and fixes my tie, and that's because I taught myself to tie my tie, and then had my dad teach me to tie my tie.
Yeah.
My son goes to a school now where he has to wear a tie every day, and one of the happiest moments of my life was watching him learn to tie a tie and participating in that. And I get to see him do that every morning. And as simple as it may seem, it's transformative. Same thing with my daughter. You know, being able to interact with a young lady at that age and see the level of confidence that she has, but at the same time, see the level of compassion that she provides and that she brings to our home. I recently had one of my goddaughters with us. She unfortunately had a brain tumor, 3-year-old, had a successful operation. And as she was recuperating at our house on the last night before they returned home, she and her 6-year-old brother came into my room and requested for my daughter to come and sleep in the room with them and their parents. And my daughter agreed. And the next morning they said, my daughter went in there and said, I'm going to lead the prayer tonight. And got them all on their knees and said, Our Father. You know, so my 8-year-old, who has just been observing us and seeing what's important, can independently bring that type of joy to another family and that type of comfort. And I think that is what being a parent is about, seeing them transform your life and then seeing them grow into the people that you would love them to be.
So we've gotten a great snapshot of Dr. Frederick, the newly appointed president. Let's now really get into talking about Howard University past, present, and future. First of all, I'd like to get your thoughts on Howard University's impact locally, nationally, and internationally.
Sure. It's a great impact. It's an impact that has many tiers of influence in many ways, shape, and form. Let's start with locally. DC, if you look at its construct, its history, Howard University has played a role in transforming what the city looks like. The education of blacks from the South that occurred on this campus allowed professionals of color to then become citizens of the district. And they went on to become leaders, to become major influencers around what occurs in the city, and that still occurs today. You look at our city council, there are no less than 3 members of our city council who are Howard alum. We continue to have that type of an impact locally, and we must. And part of my vision is to enhance our community engagement, to come up with programs that will look to do that. So we want to start a dual enrollment program where we will bring juniors from Banneker and McKinley Tech into the walls and halls of Howard and allow them to finish their GED and get a head start on college. We want to do more things with the community, get folks into our libraries on the weekend. I'm hoping to bring out Midnight Madness in basketball for the local kids in the area. We've kept our campus open because we have a responsibility to the community, and we intend to do that. On the national level, it is clear when you look at our alum, everybody from Vernon Jordan, LaSalle, LaFall, who in 1948 could only apply to 2 medical schools in this country and didn't get into either on his first pass.
Yeah.
But had
LaSalle LaFall, a great
LaSalle
surgeon.
LaSalle LaFall, yeah. Exactly. And he, I think, is one of the greatest surgeons ever produced in this country, mm-hmm. but was able to come to Howard University and get that opportunity. We've influenced every field. That's a contemporary experience today,
yeah.
right? If you look at Kamala Harris, the Attorney General in California, is a Howard alum. The mayors of Newark and Atlanta, you know, Baraka and Reed are Howard alum, and I can go on and on. So the national impact through what our alum have done is important. And I must underscore, when you look at the civil rights era, you look at Brown versus the Board of Education, the constructs of that strategy were in Howard's Law School or products of Howard Law School. Neighborhood, you look at Thurgood Marshall, and again, I think we have contributed in a vast manner.
You know, if I can say something there.
Sure.
You may or may not know, I sort of came out of the crazy world of boxing.
Right.
We had a press conference of Mike Tyson on Howard University's campus back in 2005. Mm-hmm. He shocked everyone when we talked about that this was the campus of Thurgood Marshall.
Right.
That he couldn't get into the University of Maryland, but he came to Howard University and all of his great history. So right. Tyson was quiet, and then when he was introduced, he said, I think it's an injustice to to talk about Thurgood Marshall and not talk about Charles Hamilton Houston. And then talked about Charles Hamilton Houston's work, his teachings of Thurgood Marshall's and others, and his helping to construct that civil rights, Brown versus Board of Education case.
Yep.
I found that very fascinating.
No, and I'm not surprised, because on many an occasion while I was a student at Howard, I lived in the Towers building and would come out and meet Mr. Tyson in the hallways, probably for other reasons, but nevertheless, he clearly was familiar with our campus and the impact it had.
Yeah.
And then when you talk about internationally, I mentioned to you already, the independence that Trinidad got from Britain was constructed by a man who was a political science professor here on Howard's campus and became our first prime minister in the form of Eric Williams. Today, the Prime Minister of Grenada, Dr. Mitchell, who is one of our grads from our math department. You can go on and on throughout the African diaspora in Africa, where we have put leaders in place after their Howard education, and they are continuing to lead and have an impact. It is not only through our alum that we're having an impact. Our programs have had an impact as well. We have research activities that are occurring on the African continent that are impacting the daily lives, whether it's water irrigation systems or we're doing law or social work type of research on the African continent, exchange programs. We are having a continued impact internationally. So it's not lost on me that Howard University has had a very positive impact on lives locally, nationally, and internationally.
You know, rarely is it ever talked about those kinds of good things that happen. Can you share, for an example, something that the university is doing abroad that is making an impact in impoverished kind of areas?
Absolutely. Our College of Nursing and Allied Health has a grant that has taken them to Malawi. Malawi is a country that certainly is developing. They have a clinical laboratory project which allows for HIV testing throughout Malawi. So they have people going out and drawing the blood. They have couriers on motorcycles who go into these rural areas. You can't access them by car. They're bringing that back, and we built out the laboratory system to be able to test for HIV and turn around that result quickly so we can get antiretrovirals to those patients. Massive impact. I would even argue that if that project was shut down today, we would probably cripple the healthcare system in Malawi because of the impact that testing has. In Zambia, we have a program through the College of Pharmacy where we have educated community pharmacists and armed them with the ability to treat patients with HIV so that you take away the stigma of them going to an HIV clinic in a hospital. They can go to their pharmacist to get their meds. The labs that they have done are sent, the laboratory results are sent to the pharmacist, and they can look at that and say, okay, your CD4 count is low, let me go ahead and start you on some type of prophylaxis from a particular type of pneumonia. That interaction is then sent to the primary physicians at the hospital. That impact that they're having in the community is fabulous, and when I had the opportunity to visit there, I was overwhelmed by what Howard University is doing in a palpable fashion to making these people's lives better. This is not stuff that's just on a chalkboard. It's not stuff that's stored on somebody's computer. Mm-hmm. It is stuff that is touching people's hearts every single day, and Howard University is doing that.
Let me look in the camera here and say this. And it's not just hyperbole when I say Howard University is the greatest institution of higher learning in the history of the world. You're finding out today how and why. Let me maybe get you in a little bit of trouble here, see if I can get you to make what will probably be a tough choice. We talked about Howard people, Howard grads. If you had to tap one or two or three, I won't try to pigeonhole you and say just tap one, but one or two or three people that came through Howard and has most significantly impacted the world, what names come to mind?
I would say Clive Callender comes to mind.
Who?
Clive Callender.
Okay.
He is not a Howard grad. I had the opportunity to give him an honorary degree last year, but he has spent most of his career here at Howard University, and I think the body of his work is a product of Howard and a product of what we do. He saw a problem when he first came to Howard as a resident in terms of an emerging field of study in transplantation. Minorities weren't being transplanted, we didn't donate organs, etc. He went out to Minnesota and was trained in transplantation and came back to Howard University. And I would say that he has had the singular greatest impact on minority organ transplantation than any single person in the world. And that's not a very small task.
Yeah.
Renal failure, end-stage renal disease, really afflicts our community greatly. And he was able to convince minorities to sign their organ donor cards in quantities never seen before.
Uh-huh.
He was also able to move the transplant community to recognize that African Americans and other minorities should be on lists to get transplantation. And what he has contributed, in my opinion, has absolutely transformed the world in terms of what he has brought. I won't name a single individual, mm-hmm. but our fine arts department has transformed what we think about African-American culture. And I can't name an individual because the plethora of individuals
yes.
we have produced have
yes.
helped define
yeah.
African-American art and culture
yeah.
in this country and exported it well beyond its shores
yeah.
without failure and consistently have done that throughout the years. And I think that clearly they've done that. In the area of religion, I still think that I will always hold this man as a Howard man. I know that he has a degree from elsewhere, but Thurman is one of the greatest.
Howard Thurman.
Howard Thurman is one of the greatest I think we've produced. And I think when we look back at what he did in terms of how he intersected race, politics, and where we needed to be, as a society, I think that he also transformed that field. But it doesn't stop there.
Yeah.
And as you said, it's a tough question. You want to give me one, two, or three. But again, the products of our law school.
Yes.
We spoke about that already, but we also have to talk about the contemporary men and women who transform it, the Vernon Jordans.
Yeah.
There's no one that I have met with greater strategic presence and political influence mm-hmm. than Vernon Jordan.
Mm-hmm.
In the right place, at the right time, with the right types of influence that is needed. So we have really produced, I think, people who have gone out and really transformed the world around them. And I think we have to celebrate what that is. But we also have a sacred obligation, because that impact has been so great, to make sure we're making a way for others to do the same.
You know, and that leads me now to your taking over as the 17th president reminded me a little bit of Barack Obama being elected. And he came in with perhaps the greatest challenges in American history. You've come into Howard University at a time where the challenges are multiple, and we can start with the finances. We start with the business. The university is deeply in debt. So I'd like to talk about, you know, your strategy for how you might be able to manage that debt, and also get into sort of the rudimentary of how the university is even funded. How is it kept afloat?
Sure. You know, excellent question. Before I answer that directly, I have to say that my only association with Mr. Obama is my son looking at the television asking me why I am not the president.
So why did you fail?
That's right. He has certainly raised the bar, let me tell you, in my household. So let's look at how the university is funded. We have three main revenue streams. And when I say three main, these account by far and large for the largest amount of money that's coming into the university, well over 90%.
Okay.
Tuition, mm-hmm. the clinical revenue, and the federal appropriation that we receive.
Right.
Those are not revenue streams that are expanding,
yeah.
right? When you talk about tuition, our Pell Grant eligibility is rising. Mm-hmm. 60% of our students are Pell Grant eligible. 30% of that 60% are students whose expected family contribution is zero. They get the maximum Pell Grant award, which is about $5,800.
Yeah.
Our tuition is $22,000. So there's no private institution that will mirror those types of numbers.
Yeah.
My sister schools in the city, all three of them, have a Pell Grant eligibility in their undergrad campus from 11% to 19%. Mm-hmm. We are at 60%.
Wow.
So that tuition stream is not going to expand in a real way. So we have to be cautious about raising tuition, et cetera, because we don't have a student body that is actually writing checks to come here in a large quantity. The federal appropriation, you know what's going on in Congress. And expanding any type of spending now, regardless of the return on investment that I believe we provide that warrants an increased investment, is not going to occur as well. So we have to look at that federal appropriation as a fixed amount, and we can't rely on that expanding anytime soon. And then that brings us to the clinical revenue. Healthcare has changed.
Before you go to clinical revenue, let me ask you, because there's always been the challenge that the president of this university, to some extent, had to play nice, was beholden or whatever to federal appropriations. What's your approach and what's your relationship on Capitol Hill?
Sure. So I'm developing very good relationships on Capitol Hill. We've been interacting with congressmen and senators, and what I'm trying to do is to bring the message to them that the investment in Howard University through the federal appropriation is providing a return well beyond the measure of the investment that is being put. And a lot of what we have discussed in terms of how our grads and how our faculty have changed the world around us is where that return on investment is. And we have to keep making that case. So my approach is, I am here to engage you about what Howard University has done, what it is doing, and what it will do. And that narrative is one that will make you feel, as a congressman or senator, that you need to make sure that that federal appropriation is expanding, not just sitting stagnant, because the return on investment is great. So I have a very proactive approach that involves engagement, and we also are going to make sure internally that we're doing the things around graduation rate and retention rates that would justify it. Now, back to that question, the third one is the clinical revenue. The healthcare system has changed dramatically. And having a university-owned hospital of our size means that we cannot compete. The type of investment you need in equipment to turn it over, the state-of-the-art equipment, on a regular basis, not on a 10-year basis, on an every-year basis. Things are changing so rapidly.
Yeah.
People want the latest technology to be provided, and that requires a significant investment. We are not positioned to be able to do those types of things on a regular basis. So what we must do is find a circumstance for the clinical revenue in the form of the hospital and the practice of the physicians that will bring us the best educational laboratory that we can hope to have. And that means that we have to find a circumstance where we have a joint venture or some type of a management circumstance for the hospital.
I was going to ask you,
what is the
strategy to allow the hospital to survive? Because many have predicted its demise.
Right. I think we have to get involved in a bigger system where we can use the scales of economy, or we have to get involved in a better management structure or construct deal that would allow for the types of things to happen that would allow us to operate efficiently, have a good revenue cycle management that will produce the types of dollars that we need to produce in terms of revenue. Now, those are the three main revenue streams. We have to diversify those, though. We have to create other new revenue streams. And so my plan is to look at that issue. We have real estate holdings. Can we monetize those in a way that would bring us more revenue? We have intellectual property like no other, whether it's our art, our ideas around what we should be doing about health, whether it's coming out of our social work arena. All around this campus, our intellectual property is very, very, very enormous, and we have to maximize how we use that. And I think, again, we would have a great opportunity to create a large revenue stream out of the intellectual property.
Something near and dear to my heart are athletics.
Yeah.
I happen to have participated in athletics in baseball when I was here in undergrad. It seems as if we've had frustration after frustration. It seems as if we've been of the mindset that top flight athletics doesn't necessarily reconcile with high academic achievement. Many schools such as Stanford and Duke and other, you know, have certainly proved that philosophy wrong, if it ever was a philosophy.
Right.
What, if anything, can we do? You got any plans to take athletics from sort of a ho-hum, sort of running along, barely limping along, and make it something that can help attract students, produce revenue? What's the plan?
So, Mr. Newman, let me be clear.
Yeah.
When I came here as a freshman and I was the manager of the soccer team in fall of 1988, that fall semester culminated in that soccer team qualifying for the NCAA Division I Final Four. Mm-hmm. We won the semifinal game and lost the final game in Indianapolis on Indiana's campus.
Yeah.
So my experience, my very first Howard experience with athletics was one of winning. We basically finished second in the country in a Division I sport.
Yeah.
And that was my experience.
Yeah.
So needless to say, when I turned my television on in March for March Madness, I was expecting to see Howard University basketball there.
Sure.
And winning.
Yeah.
It is my expectation today that we can win and we can play well and compete and also compete in the classroom. Our athletes are graduating at a higher rate than the rest of our population, and that is because the NCAA rules allow for a very insulated and appropriate environment for them to pursue their academics. I have no doubt that we can recruit the best of the best and we can provide winning teams, but it means we must invest.
Yeah.
Our facilities must be up to mark. We have an AstroTurf field, as you know, that we play football on. We've had a plethora of injuries, and so I made a decision this summer to change the AstroTurf.
Yeah.
We have to produce the right type of field to prevent the injuries so our athletes who we do recruit, who can play, can win.
Sure.
We've had a transformation of our gym recently, our Bird Gymnasium, in terms of what the locker rooms look like. So when athletes come, they can see state-of-the-art facilities. I sent my athletics team out, my athletics director and his assistant, I sent them out to Notre Dame mm-hmm. to take a look. I want them to see what the best in class looks like and bring that back to the university to push me and agitate me for resources that would allow them to have the best. So our intent is to have the best athletics program we can have, and that does not mean that we don't win. That I want them to graduate at a high rate. I want them to go out and recognize that they're not all going to become pro athletes. But while they're here playing varsity sports at Howard, I expect them to win.
We've got a little over 2 minutes left here. You, as the interim president, received some criticism leading into the May graduation. You had a controversial speaker. His name was Diddy. What made you choose him? And are you comfortable that that was a good decision? Now that it's over in hindsight.
Sure. So on October 1st of last year, when I was named interim president, it so happened that I had a dinner meeting set up with Sean Coombs, which I went ahead and I kept. So the events of September 30th, that evening when I was approached about being the interim president and the announcement was coming out, this dinner meeting was already set up in my role as provost and looking at him as an alum who I felt could contribute to the university. And I sat with him and a couple of his folks, and we had dinner. And just as I had suspected, I was absolutely enthralled. That August, I came out of a hotel room in Toronto, and there was a newspaper outside my room with a big picture of Sean Coombs talking about WHUT-TV. Yeah. As I read the article, he mentioned Howard in the most glowing terms, and that's why I wanted to sit with him. Mm-hmm. When I sat with him at that dinner, I saw a Howard man. I saw somebody influenced and changed and transformed by Howard. And it convinced me that he was the right type of person to represent the university. And I think it was a solid decision. I wasn't going to argue it in the press. I was just going to let him do his thing and have other people convinced that he was the right person to deliver the right message. And I think he did that.
So you're satisfied with the presentation and all that came with it?
I'm more than satisfied. He is an entertainer. There's always going to be risk. He hasn't done everything in his life, you know, correctly, but a lot of us haven't. Our kids who are graduating and our kids who are here have lots of challenges. Many of them drop out because of financial circumstances. He left here in good academic standard and pursued a route to success that was non-traditional. He admitted himself during his speech that he wished that he had done things a certain way all the time. But there's no success without failure.
This is unfair, but I'm going to try to do it anyhow. We got 15 seconds. Howard University Television. Mm-hmm. We see it as an asset. Yeah. How do you see it?
I see it as a great asset. I'm here and I will be here as often as I can be to promote it, and I hope that it will promote everything about Howard University right here.
I can't thank you enough.
Thank
Dr. Frederick, thanks for being the guest today.
My pleasure. Thanks for having me.